certainly one of my favorite areas in the Bible. If there are prophecies, Paul writes, they will be brought to nothing if love fails. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially, and we prophesy partially. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk as a child, think as a child, reason as a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things. At present, we see indistinctly, as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially, then I shall know fully, as I am fully known. So faith, hope, love remain, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Please welcome again, Dr. Demeš.
Thank you very much, Stephen. It's really a great honor for me to be with you in this, as Steve told me, the oldest institution of state of Montana. I am here for 1 week because of Bill Simmons, whom I met last October in Bratislava, capital of my country. And we attended concert of Joseph Luptak and other great musicians whom we have. And Bill told me that, why don't you accompany musicians when they come spring of next year? I didn't know exactly what he wants me to do. But when I learned that he, with a group of friends, is organizing Week of Peace and Love, sort of I said that if I'm foreign policy expert and civil society or civic organizer, I will try to experiment and do one thing what goes a bit beyond what I do day to day. I will be speaking about a man who is associated with love, who is a historical figure, but who has influenced globally history. So I will be walking you through the life of this man. But before I mentioned it at MSUB, where I spoke about European affairs and what's going on, and so it was more foreign policy type of lecture. These will be photo lecture, but I will use this little funny thing, how Peace of Love saved me at Denver Airport. Because when I landed on Sunday, I was a little nervous whether the officer will let me go, because I have in my passport some stamps from complicated today countries like Iraq and others. And sometimes people, when they have stamped passport, officers may start worry and study who the person is. So the lady, after I did four fingers and thumb, look here. So she looked through my eyes and thought I'm okay, but then she opened passport and she said, why are you coming to this country? And I said, I'm going to attend Week of Peace and Love in Billings. And she says, what? And then stamped my passport. And then... So those of you, and I had printed copy of this thing developed when she would question what I'm going to do this country. So here I am. And I will try to do something experimental, because I didn't have lecture on this format, which I will try to contribute to this week, which you have in Billings. I will be using photographic curriculum vitae method, which is that when I pick this man who has the same name as I do, because Pavol is Paul, and my father is Pavol. And a couple of years back, when there was 2000th anniversary of birth of Paul of Tarsus, or Apostle Paul, I said that I do not know too much about this man. And I dedicated 2 years traveling, not constantly traveling, but traveling to original sites associated with birth, work, up to the place where he's resting now. And I tried to map how and what those places mean for people today, 2,000 years later. And also, I try to study and see artistic expressions, how people depicted Paul. And I thought that while I will be traveling from birth to death of this man, I will have enough time to think through. And photography is a good thing because you have to go there, take picture and understand what you do in order to develop caption. Otherwise, it is difficult for photographer to present that. Just briefly, who Paul was. Many people think that we know who Paul was. But he is the most unusual type of very courageous, rebellious type, who for me was interesting because he was a Jewish rabbi, whom we Christians consider to be saint, and he was born in today's Turkey, which is Muslim country. So I felt that this is quite good because you are hitting almost everything. So I said that I will be also trying to look at who and what this guy contributed, why he is so special for historical and spiritual reasons for all of us. And key issues, and this is last slide before we'll dive into his life and places associated with it, is that I try to look and travel and depict places 2,000 plus minus years later, how do they look? I try to understand what happened where he was there. And lastly, and I will speculate at the end of journey, what would happen if Paul would travel the same route now? Whether he would be allowed to travel, and how would people treat him? So this will be the end of my presentation. We are starting, so basically geographically we will be talking then about Roman Empire, where Paul traveled through his missionary journeys, and so he was born and died and traveled through space, which was then Roman Empire, and today it spans from Israel up to Italy, Rome. So this is what we are going to travel through. Interesting, the largest number of sites associated with Paul are in today's Turkey. Very often we forget that Turkey has most magnificent early Christian heritage, and this is the place where Paul was born and lived, in Tarsus, which was port city then, and in Turkey they still keep this as a tourist site, and they did some digging and found foundations of house where Paul lived. But most interestingly, there is this well, which is called St. Paul's Well, where they used to dig, and but now also, not only historically, but from the point of view of physical changes which occurred in 2,000 years. When Paul was born, his father was Roman citizen, thus Paul was Roman citizen even if he was Jew. They were making tents in Tarsus, so Paul learned how to make tents. This was his first profession. But today Tarsus is about 10 miles from the sea, because ground grew. So today it is no more port city, but when Paul was about 15, he was a gifted guy and they had some relatives in Jerusalem, so he was sent for education then to Jerusalem. But today in Tarsus there is a little church which is dedicated to Saint Paul. Paul went to Jerusalem when he was 15, and as you know, in Jewish tradition, when boy is 13. So I tried to find somebody looking like Paul when he arrived there. So there was this bar mitzvah type of ceremony, like welcoming 13-year-old. So Paul was about 2 years older than this guy, close to Wailing Wall or Western Wall in Jerusalem, because one thing what surely remained, what Paul was associated with, a remnants of their temple. So I depicted this guy there, and this is detail of Wailing Wall, which is the only thing what remained from those days magnificent and large Jewish temple. Paul studied at Gamaliel's school. He was famous rabbi, and Paul was very gifted student. But he, when Paul was born around 505 AD, and when Jesus was crucified, first martyr, Saint Stephen, who was stoned to death in front of gate, which is called Lion's Gate, now it is called Saint Stephen's Gate. So Paul attended this brutality, and he was okay with it because people felt that what these Christians, which in those days they were not called Christians, but grouped around Jesus, they started to spread new type of religion, believing that Jesus was Messiah, and they distorted the environment, and Paul thought that they need to kill as soon as possible those who started this new religious movement in Palestine. So after St. Stephen was stoned, Paul was going to Damascus with a group of soldiers to hunt down first Christian community, which settled already and started secretly working on developing small community of those who were attached to Jesus. Road to Damascus, so then I traveled to Damascus trying to find a place when Jesus was talking to, risen Jesus was talking to Paul. Paul never met Jesus, even if he lived already at those days when Jesus lived. And there is this unique moment when he sort of was struck by light, lost sight, and then this is statue which is in Damascus when Paul is falling off horse and listens, what are you going, where are you going, what do you want, and so on. So Paul was completely confused. And I tried to find, this was most difficult out of all my sort of exploration, to find the spot where this happened. It's about 10 miles from Damascus. Damascus is here. There is a little Greek Orthodox church with statue of St. Paul, which was built there. So this is this that place where we believe that this was before he arrived to Damascus, where all of this happened. And there is also the psychological thing, sort of experience of Damascus Road when somebody is changing suddenly, completely. So Paul lost sight, and then after he arrived with soldiers who went in, wanted to capture those who believed in Jesus, that they brought him to Ananias, who was leader of that religious community, and there is house of Ananias with underground chapel, and Ananias baptized Paul. So Jew who came to capture and bring back to Jerusalem, which is about 1 week walk on and using horses and walking from Jerusalem. So Paul was baptized, and there is chapel underground, which is used today in Syria, but none of us can go to Syria because of obvious reasons. I did it a couple of years ago. So there is active chapel when they serve. But when soldiers and others were part of this mission to capture believers in Jesus, learned that Paul was converted to new religion, that he was baptized, they tried to capture and kill him. So those early future Christians then helped Paul to escape, and there is this gate from where he was lowered in basket. This is in the chapel, and escaped and went for a short time to Jerusalem, where he met apostles. And then he spent, according tradition, probably few years in desert when he was contemplating and basically prepared himself for his future life. From there he went back to Tarsus for a while, and with one of the apostles, Barnabas told him, okay, no more Tarsus, come and we will go to Antioch. And in Antioch, this is in Turkish-Syrian border city, something most remarkable happened. Paul met Peter, Apostle Peter there, who also had to flee Palestine after all these changes happened, after crucifixion. And this is church called St. Peter's Church, because this is cave, and in that cave early Christians were meeting. Very few people know that very term Christian was born not in Jerusalem or today's Israel, but in today's Turkey, in city of Antioch. Antioch then was third largest city in Roman Empire after Rome and Alexandria. This was third largest city, very significant, where Paul and Peter had quarrels how they should call themselves, those who believe in Jesus as Messiah. And here, for me, this was very fascinating discovery for myself. Several of you probably may know it, that the key dilemma, what Peter and Paul, who were like yin-yang of those days and are today, they struggled what Jesus meant. That when principality of love was coined by Jesus, Peter's interpretation was that you can become follower of Jesus only if you are Jew. Paul was arguing it's not true, you didn't understand his message. Peter had trouble with that, because how come I lived with the man and I saw his crucifixion and I was part of this, you didn't meet him. Who are you to tell me what he meant? And this was first significant quarrel, which led to first council of elders, and they came to conclusion that Paul's interpretation is right. Christian can be not only ethnic Jew, but as they call them, Gentiles, non-Jewish people as well. With this fundamental breaking point, Paul had ground for his missionary journeys. So Paul became the biggest traveler of early Christianity, because he started to spread the message what Jesus meant, because he, as highly educated rabbi, he was also capable then transmitting the message, explaining it, and so on. So the very term Christians and Christianity was born in Antioch, today's city Antakya, on Turkish-Syrian border, because people said, we will be calling ourselves Christians now on. Then it opened, so once Paul got this sort of certificate from elders, Christian leaders those days, he started to undertake his missionary journeys. And the first one went to Cyprus, because Apostle Barnabas was born in Cyprus, he knew the place. So, and today this is city of the archaeological site in northern Cyprus called Salamis. This is already only archaeological site today, but beautifully preserved. So in Salamis, this was first place where they started to talk to groups. Usually what happened, Paul, whenever he went, usually had 2-3 people with him. The first thing what they did, they went to synagogue to start talk first to Jews, believing that they will be more open to accept this new religion which was evolving, but then only after visiting synagogues they went and started to meet people who were non-Jewish believers of various other things and tried to talk to them. So after Salamis they went to city of Paphos. Today Paphos is existing city, but at the edges is this archaeological site when which was seat of proconsul, like leader of the region. And in here in Paphos he started to have first problems, because wherever he went he distorted status quo. Paul was rocking the boat wherever he went. This was not calm and easy thing. And in Paphos we have first, this is column or pillar, where he was flogged. Paul was very often beaten and imprisoned on his missionary journeys because he was spreading something which for Jews was problematic, because he was telling that Jesus was Messiah. But most Jews said that, how come? Jewish leadership and elders didn't believe that. Or when he went among polytheistic groups, they didn't buy this, or it was very difficult and tricky for him. So anyhow, this was first place associated with serious trouble what Paul had. And then today Barnabas, who was accompanying him, is buried in this little chapel which is in northern Cyprus, and he is patron saint of Cyprus ever since. Out of Cyprus they hit the sea and went, today you know where Antalya is, this is one of the main touristic destinations. This picture is Apollo, the temple dedicated to Apollo. So they arrived through sea to this place of southern Turkey, and Paul went through several cities in this part of the world, Pamphylia and Galatia and those provinces of Turkish Empire. I was, this is Aspendos, one of the Greek cities which have been beautifully preserved archaeological site. This was theater, and then this is Perge, another well-preserved thing. So those days Paul was traveling through major cities where he tried to meet people, talk to them about new religion. This is from Pamphylia. It is already in the middle of Turkish, of Anatolian Peninsula, but also quite well-preserved place. And this is city of Hierapolis. This is well-known Pamukkale travertine. Is one of the UNESCO sites, protected, and on the top of this is a city called Hierapolis, where he visited as well. And on his second, so, and he came back after these two, after his journeys, first journey he came back to Antioch, where he served again and developed his, he worked on developing new church with others. But his second journey went was to Europe. So this the first hit of Europe was in then Neapolis city. They anchored here, and this is one of the nicest places which I associated with. These are Philippi. So one of the letters to Philippians. All these letters then Paul was writing to communities which he visited, which were part of his follow-up work from visiting those communities, where he was able to convert some people, others were not believing so much. But today's part of Philippi is beautifully preserved site. And this is, Paul had troubles in Philippi as well. This used to be prison where Paul was kept, and there are some miraculous thing associated with that. But anyhow, this was the part of the Philippi, then large city, where he was imprisoned. Then he continued and went to Thessalonica. Thessalonica then was, and today it's second largest city in Greece. And So he stayed some time and wrote then sort of later on letter to Thessalonians. So these are remnants of city from those days. And there is this Vladaton monastery on the hill about Thessalonica where Paul used to preach. There is small chapel inside where people believe stone where he was preaching. And I entered, I was there during Easter time, and I just depicted a holy mass there. Then from there he went to Berea, and this is altar called Altar of Paul on the place where synagogue used to stay. And out of that he went to Athens. And in Athens he had very complicated time because philosophers in Athens had trouble to listen to this guy who came. And this is Mars Hill, Acropolis is very close, and here traditionally this was birth of democracy because the council used to meet on this hill, and so this was like early parliament where they were discussing issues. So Paul was arguing, but he left Athens terribly displeased because these philosophers just sort of couldn't get along with him, and he left the city without support. He went then to Corinthus. So what Steve was reading to Corinthians, Corinth played very important role for Paul. Those earlier places he stayed for a few weeks, few months, but in Corinth he stayed for 18 months, so 1.5 years. And Corinth was port city in south, it is in south of Greece, which was associated with sexual immorality, because this was a city of sin. So, and Paul felt that he needs to stay there longer and meet and talk, so he worked here. When he came to Corinth, he was not only preaching, but he found Aquila and Priscilla couple who had tent business, so he physically worked. Paul was interesting thing that he was not classical preacher. He always emphasized necessity to work and to earn money. And so he was a very practical guy. So he stayed in Corinthus for 18 months, and there are beautiful, still beautiful archaeological site there. And this is hill called Acrocorinth, and on the top was castle. So if you visit Corinth, you still can somehow feel. And this is one of the places where most likely he stood, because this was platform where people, when they were judged or sued, or when there were some legal procedures, local ruler was standing here and was conducting all these procedures. And Jews had troubles with Paul in Corinth, and they brought him in front of this judicial council. So whenever I was at these historical sites, I always tried to sort of try to understand what could have happened and where it. Sometimes you couldn't recreate it even with big imagination, but in Corinthus, this was the place where if he was there, he would be standing here. Then on his third missionary journey, the key city which he visited, because on these roads he always stopped in these settlement villages, cities, but most significant thing on his third missionary journey was Ephesus. Ephesus was huge city then, where he stayed the longest during his missionary journeys. It was about 3 years which he spent in Ephesus, where he tried to. It was a large city then, today doesn't exist, it is in ruins, but out of all places which I visited, which I associated with Paul, Ephesus is the best preserved part where one can understand logic of the city with all of its infrastructure. And since I am at university, I wanted to pick something what would please students. This used to be library. So this is called Celsus Library, and Austrian archaeologists sort of preserved and conserved and developed many nice things. So Ephesus is something very worthwhile to visit, because from the point of view of understanding how ancient cities looked like, Ephesus is best preserved of all. Then Paul came from this third journey back to Jerusalem, and then trouble started. Jewish leaders and rabbis and all of these top clergy was so angry with these men who traveled throughout the Roman Empire and was spreading something totally unacceptable for them. They crucified one of their guys who pretended that he is Messiah, and they already heard word of mouth marketing worked even during those days. And when he came home, they started to have trouble with him, and they wanted to imprison and kill him to stop what he was doing. But since it was Roman Empire, local Roman leader kept him and put him in Caesarea to prison. So Paul was rescued from Jews by Romans, and he used following argument. Since I am Roman citizen, I should be put on trial in front of Roman emperor, not by Jewish leaders. So, and somehow Romans said, okay, fine, you will go to Rome and you will be put on trial there. So it took then, so he spent 2 years in prison in Caesarea, north of Jerusalem, and then they took him by ship to Rome. When he waited, and on the way from Caesarea, he stopped in a city called Sidon. This is Sidon port, it is today Lebanon. Sidon is still a flourishing port city which you can visit. And this is called Sea Castle. This was built later by crusaders. But in Sidon, what is interesting, there is church of St. Paul and St. Peter and Paul, which I visited and met. So there is Peter and Paul. So there is church dedicated to them, because Paul, on the way to prison, on the way to Rome, he stopped by there. He arrived to Rome in about 60 AD, after all these years of traveling and missionary journeys. And in Rome, he waited for trial. And he was put, and how life played the game, he met with Peter in Antioch, where they quarreled and eventually developed friendship, partnership, and they ended up in Rome in prison. There is a building called Mamertinum where both Peter and Paul were imprisoned and waited there for their final days. And Paul was waiting for this trial during Emperor Nero, and year 64 or 65. This is what we are as close as we can, according studies of Bible and history. Paul was then, so he was beheaded. Peter was crucified down sort of reverse way, as Jesus' tradition goes. And in the place where he was beheaded, it was behind the walls of Rome, there is this three fountain church, and all this complex, it is kept by Benedictine order. So they believe that he was beheaded in this place where church stands, and this is inside the church interior, and there is this depiction of beheading Paul in the church. And then Paul was buried in Rome in cemetery. And once Christianity became official religion of Roman Empire, then they built church. And today this is second largest basilica in Rome after Basilica of St. Peter. This is Basilica of St. Paul. and I will walk you. So this is a statue of Paul, and we will go inside. So this is one of the beautiful churches there, and here, just in front of altar, there is a place Paul is buried here. They did special search and they dig out pieces of bones and did this analysis when and so on. So it is, this is not only empty, but there are some pieces of bones which very strongly suggest that this is real place where Paul is buried. And this is just a close-up of that statue of Paul in front of Basilica, which is one of the beautiful depictions of him. An artist here wanted to use something about him which protects him from light, which in Damascus blinded him. So this was the idea of artist. And this is another depiction of Paul in front of St. Peter's Basilica. Very often people, when they go to Rome and Vatican, when they stand in front of this magnificent church, they do not recognize that there are, on the left is St. Peter's statue, on the right is St. Paul. So this is in front of St. Peter's Basilica, and Paul is depicted with sword and book. Always these are attributes of him, because book is related to his wisdom and his scholarly approach to think, and sword shows that he was beheaded. And then I try to find and ask, where is the oldest depiction? We are coming to the end. I try to find the oldest depiction, how he looked. Because artists have a lot of imagination and they can do things like this or like that. And just it was about 10 years ago, they discovered in catacombs in Rome, which are not open yet for the broader public, frescoes in catacomb. Among them, on these frescoes, there is also depiction of portrait of Paul. It was forbidden to photograph, but I sinned. Indeed, so this is how Paul looked like. This is from 4th century. So this is oldest depiction how the man looked like. He was bald, beard, as good rabbi should have. He was short, according to all kinds of traditions and descriptions, because there are many experts who study all details of Paul. By the way, there is discipline called Paulinology in theology, so some people study Paul all their life. So, but anyhow, so this is how artists in 4th century, just few centuries after he was beheaded, depicted him in catacombs. And if you ask me, out of all painting, pictures, frescoes, statues, which for me is the closest after I did in 2 years this journey, which resembles me the most, how the man looked like, I selected this mosaic for you. It is from 1300s in Byzantine church in Istanbul. And I think Paul looked like this, for sure. And then, last three slides, my speculation, and then I will open it for your questions, comments, criticism. If Paul would walk through the same things now, 2,000 years later, what would happen? I think that Paul would have enormous troubles to travel. And even billboard or poster with says week of peace and love wouldn't help him to cross many borders. I just looked at how world changed geographically and politically. In those days it was Roman Empire. And I walked you through countries like Turkey, Israel, Lebanon, Syria, Greece, Cyprus, and Italy. These were countries where Paul went through. Today, if he wanted to go from Israel, from Jerusalem, to visit fellow Christians there, he couldn't cross the border. He wouldn't be allowed. Once you have stamp in passport that you visited Israel, you will be not allowed to travel to Lebanon, or you will not be able to travel to Syria. Today in Syria, even we can't travel because there is war there. Over 500,000 were killed in the last couple of years in their civil war, and over 2 million people had to flee Syria. So even we, and what I showed you, some of those images, I wouldn't be able now to go there because you simply can't go there. So I think that Middle East is remaining one of the hottest spots where you have trouble to travel. And if Paul would want to go there and do anything, he wouldn't be allowed. Not only because of stamping passport, but because of what he would say would be totally unacceptable by authorities, both state and religious. And I think that in Jerusalem, which today, because in the meantime, after Judaism and emerging Christianity, to which Paul contributed the most significant way, in the meantime, Islam was born. And for Islam, Old Testament is okay. New Testament, with which Paul is associated, is not okay, because they have their prophet. They still think that Jesus is prophet, but Prophet Muhammad is bigger than him. And we are having all these clashes where Jerusalem is the best place to see these very complicated to understand situation that three monotheistic religions, which believe that we are children of Abraham, because there are constantly some issues which are going on in between Arabs and Jews and so on. So those of you who've been to Jerusalem know that in good times it's fine, but if not, sort of sometimes you are not even allowed to walk on the Mount Temple. This is Damascus today. Damascus, capital of Syria, is the oldest continuous capital city in the world. One would expect that this city, which when I visited, this was one of the safest places I've been to. You could walk in the night, so because it was a very secure place. Today, the city is in total chaos, and problems and dying is becoming part of reality for years, and we do not know, as international community, how to handle situation to help to stop this misery, because many refugees from Syria are now flooding to Europe and are causing all kinds of issues which you read about, and which are caught. This is not something which is out there, but all what's going on in this city and this country is influencing international relations, politics, and so on. And as you know, just a couple of weeks ago, US was engaged in air campaign and bombing airport not far away from here. And this is Cyprus. Cyprus is divided. Paul would have trouble to go to Cyprus because it's divided to northern Cyprus, which is Muslim under Turkish rule, and southern or rest of the Cyprus, it's part of European Union. So Paul would have trouble even to cross the border within Cyprus if he would start all his, and if he would end up in Paphos, he could be very easily flogged like he was then. So all in all, I think that Paul, when he started 2,000 plus minus years ago, all his endeavor, where he wrote his most powerful piece called Hymn to Love, I think that just proves that what all of us are engaged in, spreading this message of tolerance and love, whether you are Jew or non-Jew, what ethnicity you are, it doesn't matter. This was Paul's first call and first push. And understanding Paul, it is understanding his enormous courage, sacrifice, and capacity to overcome even tragic things what he was associated with, because he had blood on his hands because of Saint Stephen and several other things when he fought those who believed in Jesus, but later on he converted. And without Paul, people around the world wouldn't know who the man called Jesus, who was something in between man and God, was. And I tried to find out of all my journeys through this place, because mapping Paul, you can't escape from understanding why he did it. And out of all images of Christ whom I saw throughout these journeys, I consider this, for me, the most beautiful one. And I'm sure Jesus looked like this. And it is also in Turkey. It is in Hagia Sophia, which was discovered after plaster was gone, because it was, as you know, originally Byzantine church, then mosque, and it was after Atatürk came to power, Atatürk converted it to museum. And then they removed plaster, and this type of beauty occurred. So when you are in Istanbul and in Hagia Sophia, you can see this place, and you will not sin. It is allowed to take a picture of Jesus in Hagia Sophia. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Nina, and I will continue to read text from Corinthians. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves.
Thank you.